Grace and peace to you on this Pride Sunday. It's my pleasure to extend a very warm welcome to all who have gathered for worship today, and to say a very special welcome to any of you who may be visitors or newcomers in our midst. We are just thrilled that you are here with us on this special Sunday. As always, I want to extend a welcome to our Eastlink congregation who is with us via broadcast. It is good to know that you are out there and that we are worshiping together in spirit this day. Following worship, there is a time of friendship and refreshment on the lawn, hosted by some of the men of our congregation, and we invite all to make your way to the lawn following worship. Should the weather turn while we're worshiping, we'll make our way to the lower hall instead of the lawn, but I think it will be obvious in which direction we should go. Today's worship bulletins are in loving memory of relatives and friends and have been given by Kay and Doug Boylan, and we are grateful to Kay and Doug for this gift today. The sympathies of the congregation are also extended this morning to Patsy Mills on the death of her brother Gordon, and to Sandra and Mark Richardson on the death of Mark's brother Peter. We surround you with our love and prayers and pray that God's peace will rest within you and upon you in the coming days. On behalf of the congregation, I wish to extend birthday greetings to Sylvia Johnston and Vance Bryant, who both celebrate on July 26th. I wish to thank a number of people who are leading in worship this morning or who have prepared and created our worship experience for today. First, I'd like to acknowledge the members of our Affirm Committee, Valerie Down, Jane Farquharson, Reverend Gail Hopkirk, June Jenkins Sanderson, and Marianne Burke Matheson. For all of their work throughout the year and across the weeks and months, I return thanks this day and would love to thank them with a round of applause. I'm delighted to welcome two guests to our worship this morning who will be our candle lighters today. Andy Glyden, who is Pride PEI's secretary and one of the board's directors, and John Kimmel, who is Pride PEI's chair and also one of the board of directors. So welcome to our worship today, and thanks so much for being with us. Reverend Jim Culbert, who is no stranger to us, is our scripture reader for today, and Jim was our guest preacher a year ago for Pride Sunday 2018. We owe a debt of gratitude to Jim today, not only for his gift of reading, but for finding us our guest preacher for this morning. Several weeks ago, Jim called me and asked me if Trinity might be interested in having a guest preacher on Pride Sunday, and I, of course, immediately said yes. Little did I know that he was about to connect me with a bishop in the United Methodist Church in the United States. Bishop Karen Oliveto was consecrated a bishop of the United Methodist Church in July of 2016 and assigned to the Mountain Sky Episcopal Area, which includes the Rocky Mountain and Yellowstone conferences, just to give you a little bit of geographical context. Bishop Oliveto has the distinction of being the very first openly lesbian bishop in the United Methodist Church. Our good fortune here this morning is that she and her wife, Robin is also a United Church, a United Methodist deaconess, as well as a nurse anesthetist, I believe. Our good fortune is that Karen has roots in Spring Hill, Nova Scotia, and they spend their summers in Pugwash. And so they came across to the island to be with us today. And it is my sincere privilege to welcome Robin and Bishop Oliveto to our worship this morning. Music is so much the heart of worship, and so I want to thank and acknowledge Suzanne and Allison, our soloists for today, for your gifts of music. Jane Farquharson will be sharing a minute for mission and leading us in a litany of thanksgiving and intercession, Mim McGinnis and Jackie McKinnon, who I think were the first same-gender couple to be married in the sanctuary and are soon to celebrate their first anniversary. It is a great day at Trinity. You'll note, as always, announcements in our bulletin. Please note that I will be away from about 12:01 today until August 20th, and Reverend Doreen Daly and Reverend Andy L. Singer will be on duty in my absence. I also would like to lift up the fact that our organist, Don Fraser, will be playing a wonderful recital at St. Dunstan's Basilica this Wednesday at 1 o'clock. And I invite Mim McGinnis to come forward to make an announcement about the Pride Parade.
Good morning. I'm here to tell you that we are celebrating the annual Gay Pride Parade this Saturday, July the 27th. Trinity United Church will be participating again this year in the Pride Parade, and we would like everybody here in the congregation to come join us. It's going to be lots of fun. You get to hang out with a lot of cool people. We are wearing some white Pride t-shirts. You don't have to wear a white Pride t-shirt at all. Wear whatever you want. Anything goes. We do ask that you would bring your own reusable water bottle. It's going to be hot that day. We will have some water en route to replenish you. So head towards the Victoria Park by the government buildings. There's a great big parking lot behind the government buildings where we'll meet. It's off the Terry Fox Drive. We're going to meet there around 12 o'clock, so come, have some fun, hang out with some cool people. If you have any questions about the parade, please come see Jackie, Jane, or myself after the service. And if not, we're going to see, hopefully, the majority of people next Saturday at 12. Thank you so much.
Thanks, ma'am. And finally, I do invite our prayers for the 52 people who lost their homes in the fire in the apartment building this past Wednesday morning. Four of our congregation have apartments in that complex of buildings. None of us, fortunately, in the actual building. But certainly we are feeling the impact of that fire and our neighbors who have lost their homes. The Red Cross was on site immediately and has been a tremendous support. And so should you feel moved to do so, a gift to the Red Cross would be greatly appreciated. Welcome again to this Pride Sunday, and I invite Andy and John to come forward for the lighting of our candles. As Andy lights the Christ candle, we remember the words of Jesus to his followers. Let your light so shine that others may see your good deeds and glorify God. And as John lights the rainbow candle, we give thanks for the beautiful diversity in our world. Colors, languages, genders, abilities, sexual orientation, age, and expressions of faith, each one of us a reflection of love divine. As we gather to worship, we acknowledge that the land on which we gather is the traditional and unceded territory of the Abiquit Mi'kmaq First Nation. May we live with respect on this land and in peace and friendship with its people. In a moment of quiet, let us prepare our hearts for worship.
Thank you.
Come, you who are a grand spectrum of God's children. Come as colors of a rainbow in the sky. Please be seated. As one voice, let us pray together the words of our opening prayer. Holy One, for whom on different paths all have come, to whom on different paths all are going, make strong in our hearts that which unites us, build bridges across all that divides us. United, may we rejoice in our diversity. At one in our witness to your peace, may we be a rainbow, a reflection of your magnificent glory. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our next hymn is found on the screens and also in more voices at number 145. I invite you to remain seated for the singing of this hymn. And during the first and second verses, I invite any children who are here to join me at our bench for our time together. Good morning. Wonderful to have you here this morning, and I see some rainbows in our midst and lots of colors. That's wonderful. Well, I have a question. How many of you have in your homes pictures of you and your family? Put a hand up if you can think of places where they're hung on the wall, or maybe they're on a desk or a table somewhere. Yeah, a lot of us have pictures of our families. Well, thank you, and you can rest your arms now. I have a book that's called Families, Families, Families. It's a ton of families, different kinds of families on the front. And inside, you'll see pictures of those families hung on the wall. So I'm going to share this story with you, and feel free to get closer so you can see all the pictures as I read you the story. I'm going to take that off because it's a little slippery in this heat. There we are. Everybody see? Come on over. So, some children have lots of siblings, and there are lots of little chickens here, siblings to each other. Some children have none. Some children have two dads, some have one mom. Some children live with their grandparents, and some live with an aunt. Some children have many pets, and some just have a plant. Some children live with their father. Some children have two mothers. Some children are adopted. Some have stepsisters and brothers. Some children bunk with their cousins. Some have a mom and a pop. Some children's parents are married, and some children's parents are not. So no matter if you have a ma, a pa, a hog, this llama, 10 frogs, and a slug, or a cousin named Doug, a great-grandma Betty and a great-aunt Sue, uncles Hal, Al, and Sal, and Uncle Lou, too, one step-sis, three-step rose, two-step mums, and a prize-winning rose? A robot butler to serve you tea, the world's biggest grandpa, or whatever it might be. If you love each other, if you love each other, if you love each other, then you are a family. Let's have a prayer. And I'll invite everyone to repeat after me. God of love, thank you for our families. Thank you for the pride in all kinds of families that we celebrate today. Amen. That's wonderful. Thanks for coming up, and you're welcome to go to the activity area in the back or sit with your families.
A reading from the Gospel of Matthew. Let us listen for a word from God. Then Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, "I need to be baptized by you, and do you come to me?" But Jesus answered him, "Let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness." Then John consented. And when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. And a voice from heaven said, "This is my child, the beloved, with whom I am well pleased." May God's blessing be added to the reading of this holy word. Amen.
Good morning. It is such an honor to be with you today. Thank you so much for this incredible invitation to be with you for Pride Sunday. I'm so grateful for the witness of this church, for the LGBTQ community and allies in PEI, as you share the beauty and power of your life and love, which adds so much to the quality of life in PEI and beyond. Pray with me. Breathe on us, breath of God. Fill us with life anew. In our time of worship, may we encounter your Spirit and be led to a place of love, of hope, of justice and compassion. Amen. Before I start, I just have to say, it's the weirdest thing. There is a thermometer on this pulpit. I don't even have to look at it to say, I know the temperature, it's hot. I want to share a story with you that I think has great significance for queer folk. She always knew there was something different about her boy. She saw the big and little telltale signs from the very beginning. The way he spoke, the way he moved in the world, all proved to her what she wanted to deny. And then there were those friends of his. If they weren't a dead giveaway, she didn't know what was. They never talked about it, but it was clear he was talking to someone. She caught him once or twice talking in hushed tones, but he only brushed her off if she asked about it. She suffered in the way only a mother could, holding so many conflicting and confusing emotions in her heart, sadness and joy, grief and hope, denial and anticipation. She knew that someday he would claim who he really was, and life would be even more difficult for him. And like every mother, the realization clung to her like a dreaded dead weight. They were attending a social function together. His friends were with them. They didn't go anywhere without each other. She realized, looking at him, that he was more than just her boy now. And in that moment, denial turned into resignation, turned into acceptance. She knew that now was the time for her boy to claim the man that he was created to become. There appeared to be a crisis at the event. She would never have guessed that this would be the time and place, but there you have it. She elbowed him and motioned to the bartender. Jesus, they're out of wine. The implication was clear. If he was taken aback by this sudden shove out of the closet, he didn't show it. Without skipping a beat, he grumbled back, Mother, stop it. It's not my time. Who would have guessed that Jesus would be outed by his own mother? By claiming who he was created to be, by leaving the closet and allowing his mother to out him as the savior of the world, Jesus offers us a very basic lesson in the importance of coming out. Not only is it good and healthy for the individual who can now live into their fullness of their God-given self, but the community benefits as well. If Jesus didn't step out and step up, the wedding would have been ruined. The joy of the day would have been overshadowed by despair and disappointment. The party would have been over. I can just hear Jesus' theme song now. Jesus models to us the importance of people being allowed to grow into their God-given selves, blessed by God, affirmed by those around them, supported by the community. When this happens, the entire community gets to grow into its very best self. When we try to deny others from being who they are, when we shut closets as tight as coffins, when we are forced to live behind masks, the soul of the community becomes brittle, the spirit of the community becomes crushed, the bonds of community are broken, and the joy, the love, the compassion we have for each other is lost. The party is over. Now, this turning of water into wine is the very first miracle Jesus performs in the Christian Gospels. It stands there as a reminder to us that this life that Jesus calls us to is a joyful one. It doesn't mean that life is always going to be a party. There will be trials and there will be tribulations, but when we undergird it in faith, there is always persistent joy. Unfortunately, faith communities haven't always claimed this joy and haven't done all in their power to ensure that all people are birthed and nurtured in this joy-filled life. In fact, faith communities, let's keep it real, have been a part of the squelching of the joy and denying the humanity of God's beloved. The racism, the sexism, the ableism, the homophobia within religious communities are signs of our brokenness and ongoing need for the change in our individual as well as common life. Oh, but when religious communities get it right, And you can attest to this. Miracles abound. Lives are turned around. Systems of oppression are dismantled, and joy is multiplied. I was blessed to serve for 8 years as pastor of Glide Memorial Church in San Francisco. This church has, for more than five decades, committed itself to living with and empowering those who live on society's margins. Whatever one's status or condition, Glide brings God's unconditional love and unconditional acceptance to those whom the world deems most unacceptable, infusing the broken with healing and hope and agency. Glide has stood with the queer community since the 1960s. Several years before there was Stonewall, there was the Council on Religion and the Homosexual. It was started at Glide by one who witnessed the oppression and violence towards LGBTQ persons in San Francisco and brought both clergy and leaders of the gay community together in the hopes of seeking change. The organization was incorporated and became the first public organization in the United States to use the word homosexual in their title. The group continued to meet, and satellite chapters were formed in several areas across the country. I don't know if there were chapters in Canada or not, but it was committed to educating religious leaders about the concerns of the LGBTQ community and enlisting their aid and advocacy work. What was remarkable about this group was that they didn't sit in church and wait for the LGBTQ community to come in. They went to where the LGBTQ people found safety and sanctuary, which at that time were very secretive gay bars that were still frequently raided, in order to learn about people's lives. A New Year's ball was held in San Francisco to raise funds for this new organization, and clergy met with police there to ensure that the dance wouldn't be raided. And the clergy attended. The police, however, snapped photos to intimidate all the people who were coming to the dance, and in the end, arrested six people. The next day, the clergy denounced the raid at a press conference at San Francisco City Hall and began a rallying cry with the LGBTQ community for justice. Oh, if only that partnership continued. I often wonder where at least we in the States would be if instead of Stonewall, which is having its 50th anniversary this year, this earlier event had sparked the historic beginnings of the gay liberation movement. How would the conversation have changed in the ensuing decades if religious communities like yourself continued to stand in solidarity with the queer community? I can't help but think of the lives that have been broken, bullied, and even ended because of the ongoing anti-queer rhetoric from people of faith who could have been made whole, healed, and saved if only religious communities continued to build a bridge into the queer community instead of erecting a wall. You know, your congregation's really quiet. I'm really used to some amens, just saying. But you Canadians are so centered and quiet compared to us. Instead, too many religious communities have deemed us acceptable if we hide who we are and who we love, or even worse, seek to change our God-given nature. As a result, closet doors hang heavily shut in too many churches. I've been so grateful for the witness of the United Church of Canada, long before any U.S. denomination made a public statement in support of LGBTQ people and pastors. You were out in front. If only this was the norm. Religions have wounded too many of our queer kin and made them wonder if they have any place at all in the family of faith. After the United Methodist Gathering of 2012, I received the saddest pastoral call of my life. The voice on the other end of the call was a former parishioner. In a voice that cracked in pain, he said this, "Pastor, will you unbaptize me?" He heard the homophobic rhetoric spoken at the meeting and it inflicted such spiritual harm that he could no longer trust in God's love for him. Pastor, can you unbaptize me? This broke my heart. Because through baptism, we get to experience a love that will never let us go. No matter what the church may decide, we are loved by God, and I love baptism. Now, I don't know your polity or a doctrine, but in the United Methodist Church, we do infant baptisms. And I love baptizing babies, because whenever we baptize a baby, we're reminded something of the nature of God. Right? There is nothing that baby has to do to earn love. She doesn't have to be a good girl. He doesn't have to behave in a particular way. Just by being, this baby is loved. Now, we're on lookout. It's about to get a lot hotter here. This is what baptism is about. You are loved, and there's nothing you can do about it. When Jeff asked to be baptized, it broke my heart and made me furious because the church failed him, failed to allow him to feel how deeply loved he is, and the church broke its promise to him, made at the time of his baptism, to love him no matter what. At your baptism, the community made a promise to you that you might forget. You are unconditionally loved and unconditionally accepted. It doesn't matter if you're gay or straight, an addict or an accountant. Our task as siblings is to provide this reminder whenever one of us forgets. In fact, turn right now and say to someone, you're loved unconditionally by God. We need this reminder. We need this reminder. One of my favorite stories in the Bible is the baptism of Jesus. I love that story. It was one of the most amazing experiences to go to the Holy Land, to put my feet in the Jordan River and remember my baptism. To remember. It was at the Jordan River where John was baptizing the faithful, and Jesus came to him, and John at first refused, but Jesus was insistent. And as he went down into that murky water, when he emerged, the Spirit of God descended from heaven and said, "This is my beloved child in whom I delight. This is my beloved children in whom I delight." Now let's do a little bit of Bible trivia. What had Jesus done up to this point? What miracle had he performed? Anybody? None. Who had he healed? He hadn't healed anybody yet. Who on the margins did he defend? No one. At this point in Jesus' life, Jesus had done none of it, nothing. He was a carpenter like his father Joseph. What did he do to warrant such pronouncement of this love, this pride, this affirmation from on high? This is my beloved child in whom I delight. Nothing. Nothing out of the ordinary. The extraordinary work and ministry that he did followed his baptism. Jesus was loved for simply being Jesus. Do you know you are loved for simply being you? Do you know that deep within your soul? It's not your accomplishments. It's not your wealth, your status that gain you love. You are loved even in those parts of you that you're ashamed of, embarrassed by, and try to hide. Do you remember who you are? Do you remember whose you are? Remember these words. You are my beloved child in whom I delight. While baptism reminds us that there's nothing we need to do to earn God's love, it's offered to us freely and abundantly because we are God's heirs, the tough part is living out this truth. It's hard to remember who we are and whose we are, especially when so many want to deny who we are or even change who we are. Especially in this time of regression against the gains we've made in LGBTQ plus rights. As a U.S. president seeks to erase transgender citizens, as the Anglican Church of Canada fails to recognize as holy the love two people of the same gender share, it is especially important to remember this truth. You've been claimed. Every single person here. No matter your sexual orientation, no matter your gender identity, no matter your ability, no matter your race, your gender, you have been claimed as God's beloved. You can choose to remember who you are and live this truth out in every moment, in every breath, or you can forget that truth. God loves us and delights in us. Do you remember who you are? When you're pushing papers at your desk, do you remember that you sit at that desk as a child of God? When you deal with your coworkers, are you being present with them as a child of God? When you stand in line at the supermarket, do you stand there as a child of God? When you are dancing at the club, do you sway with the wild abandonment of the one who knows that God delights in you? When you love, when you work through disagreements, when you walk down the street, when you get up in the morning and go to bed at night, do you live out your baptism? Remember, you are God's beloved child. God delights in you. No matter what the church might do to try to beat you down, there is a love that cannot be taken from you. Never forget that. And that leads me to Lady Gaga. It was at her concert that Robin and I went to in Oakland, California, that I heard a message of healing and hope that has surpassed almost any that I've ever heard in church. It was a rainy night, but the rain didn't dampen the spirit of the concert goers as we stood in line waiting to go in. The crowd was a wonderful mirror of the diversity we have in the California Bay Area. Hugs, laughter, singing, and dancing broke out spontaneously as the crowd inched closer to the door, except for one man. Standing close to the crowd was a man dressed with a coat covered in slogans like, "Hate the sin, love the sinner," and "Hell is for eternity." The man was shouting at the crowd so hard that the cords of his neck were bulging and his face was beet red. He shouted things like, "You're going to hell!" The man was quickly forgotten as Lady Gaga took the stage. People were swept up by her performance, and in between her songs, she asked people to give to local homeless shelters, and in particular, shelters for homeless queer youth. Then she did something I was totally unprepared for. Lady Gaga, well, she preached. She began by talking to Jesus. "Jesus, some people say you only love some certain kinds of people. Some people say that Jesus only loves one kind of person and not everybody, not every race, not every ethnicity, not every sexual orientation. But Jesus, you have blessed me. I am certain Jesus must love everybody. Jesus loves everybody." With that, the crowd acknowledged the blessing she had given them through claps and affirmation and shouts. Lady Gaga was a true evangelist in the central message of religion. You are marvelously made, and God delights in you. And God invites us to enjoy the great diversity found in creation, especially within the human family. We are to delight in our differences, to look at one another in wonder and awe. This is the core message we are to live into and share through acts of great love. We need to say to those who disbelieve they are worthy, if there are parts of you, and I say this to every person here because we all carry this, if there are parts of you that you have been taught to be ashamed of, embarrassed about, because you don't fit into some neat, nice, neat, arbitrary norm, God wants you to love those parts of yourself because God does. You were created by a God who delights in you. Know this. Honor this. You and you and you and you and you and you were marvelously made. You were born this way. So love yourself. You were born this way. Celebrate it. You were born this way. Now extend the love that you have received from God so freely to those who don't know this love, to those whom society has shackled their souls. Love them fiercely enough so that they may spring free and live this life with great joy. You were born this way. I got to come down here to remind you of this. You were born this way. Just as Mary nudged Jesus out of the closet so the party could continue, so we need you. We need you. And you know what? This life of faith that God invites us to, it is a come-as-you-are party. So let's keep the party going. Amen.
No pressure. Oof.
My mama told me when I was young, we are all born superstars. She rolled my hair up, put my lipstick on in the glass of her boudoir. There's nothing wrong with loving who you are, because she said you're perfect, babe. So hold your head up, girl, and you'll go far. Listen to me when I say I'm beautiful in my way, because God makes no mistakes. I'm on the right track, baby, I was born this way. Don't hide yourself in regret. Just love yourself and you're set. I'm on the right track, baby, I was born this way. Ooh, there ain't no other way. Baby, I was born this way. Baby, I was born this way. Ooh, there ain't no other way. Baby, I was born. I'm on the give yourself prudence and love your friends so we can rejoice your truth. In the religion of the insecure, I must be myself, respect my youth. A different lover is not a sin. Believe, capital H, I am. Hey, hey, hey. Love my life, I love this record, and mi amore vole fea. I'm beautiful in my way, cause God makes no mistakes. I'm on the right track, baby, I was born this way. Don't hide yourself in regret, just love yourself and you're set. I'm on the right track, baby, I was born this way. Ooh, there ain't no other way. Baby, I was born this way. Baby, I was born this way. Ooh, there ain't no other way. Baby, I was born. I'm on the right track. Baby, I was born this way. Don't be a drag, just be a queen. Whether you're broke or evergreen, you're black, white, beige, or let us send, you're Lebanese, you're Orient. Whether life's disabilities left you outcast, bullied or teased, rejoice and love yourself today, cause baby you were born this way. No matter gay, straight or bi, lesbian, transgender life, I'm on the right track, baby, I was born to survive. No matter black, white or beige, chola or Orient made, I'm on the right track, baby, I was born.
way. Hey.
So I have the privilege of reading the minute for mission this morning, and these are two very hard acts to follow. So I want to tell you from the very beginning that this story has a happy ending. I'm reading the minute for mission written by Justin Milne. Justin is a Charlottetown resident and a lawyer with Stuart McKelvey. Justin made a presentation to the Supper Club at Trinity United Church in May of 2019. As he says, my presentation centered around the Trinity Western University case and the broader implications that that case may present to same-sex equality rights and freedom of religion. Trinity Western is a university in British Columbia that was opening a law school. Many of you would have already heard about this case. Trinity Western also wanted law societies to accredit their graduates so that they could easily work in accredited provinces across Canada. The thorny issue was that all students and staff were required to abide by a community covenant, and that covenant included a provision that prohibited same-sex intimacy, whether they were on or off the campus. Justin has long been interested in Trinity Western proceedings. When he was living in Nova Scotia, he assisted a university organization to make submissions to the Nova Scotia Barristers Society, where they argued against accrediting the graduates from this university. The Barristers Society agreed with Justin that Trinity Western's community covenant was discriminatory. At that time, which was 3 years ago, Justin thought you could easily reconcile reconcile same-sex equality and freedom of religion. As he says, I've started to see things differently. I realize now that both equality and freedom of religion are at the core concerned with human dignity and human flourishing. A large component of freedom of religion is concerned with protecting humans from an unruly state of interference. In that sense, freedom of religion also has a strong non-discrimination component. It limits the government's ability to impose certain ideologies. Same-sex equality is premised on the same concern. The opponent to same-sex equality is not religion. The opponent is heterosexism, a view of the world that privileges or only recognizes heterosexuality. So, both same-sex equality and freedom of religion are concerned with ensuring that the world respects a diversity of viewpoints and human experience. Justin now feels that the law needs to move toward this understanding. We should look for common ground. From this starting point, I think we can easily get to our desired endpoint, a world where we are all deserving of mutual respect and concern, and an acknowledgement that sometimes self-concern must give way to the weighty issue of another person or group of persons. And for folks that are interested in more information about this Minute for Mission, I encourage you to go online and look for more information under the Supreme Court ruling of Canada, June 15th, 2018.
Thank you, Jane. Thank you, Justin. Our morning offering will now be received. Let us give as we are called. Let us give as we are able.
Some believe it's right to say Jesus when you pray. Some believe Muhammad, Allah, or Buddha are the way. Whether a god or a pantheon of gods up in the sky, I'll honor your choices and you will honor mine. Whether you are red, black, yellow, brown, or white, a man with a husband or a woman with a wife, we can debate till the end of time who's wrong and who's right, or we can honor your choices and you can an odd mind. We all want the same things from life. We want peace and love and prosperity. But can we give up our need to be right? Give the world a present, give the gift of your acceptance. Give the world a present, give the gift of your acceptance. Some believe that God's a him, and some say God's a her. Does God live here in our hearts or out in the universe? Gandhi was a Hindu, Martin Luther King a Christian. Regardless of religion, they knew love was their mission. We all want the same things from life. We want peace and love and prosperity. But can we give up our need to be right? Give the world a present, give the gift of your acceptance. Give the world a present, give the gift of your acceptance. We can debate till the end of time who's wrong and who is right, but I will honor your choices if you will honor mine. 'Cause we all want the same things from life. We want peace and love and prosperity. Can we give up our need to be right? Give the world a present, give the gift of your acceptance. Give the world a present, give the gift of your acceptance.
Receive our morning gifts, O God. Bless them and bless us, that together we might be your blessing in a beautiful and broken world. This we pray. Amen.
Please join us in prayer. Eternal God, energy of love, your liberating voice has called us here.
You have provided sanctuary for us.
You cradle us in the palm of your open hands.
You show us your light in your sun and your reflection in your moon.
We remember the LGBTQ two-spirited plus people around the world who have been tortured and killed because of who they are.
We remember the LGBTQ two-spirited plus refugees around the world seeking safety and asylum.
We remember trans and gender diverse people here in Canada, the United States, Brazil, and elsewhere who are targeted victims of hate crimes and assaults.
Bless and protect all your people.
Bless and strengthen all your people.
Bless and call all your people.
Amen. Before I give the benediction, I just want to say thank you. This is an incredible honor to be with you all. And I shared with something with Cathie beforehand, and she had asked me to share it with you. This is the first time in 2 years I have come and preached in a church and not had an armed guard. That's why your ministry is so important. You offer a freedom and safety to others because you're affirming church. That is an incredibly important ministry. So, to end, let's take the hand of someone next to us. Because you know what? A rainbow needs all the colors. It needs all of us. And look around this room. Look at the beauty. Did you know diversity is a sign of God's divinity? The God we call three in one built into diversity into the very Godhead. So when we see each other, we are seeing a piece of God's beauty. So leave this place knowing that there will be times when the world is going to want to beat out your unique self, is going to ask you to conform in ways that aren't who you are. And that's where you need the hand of the person next to you. For they will remind you, you are God's beloved child in whom God delights. Be who you are and bring this unconditional love. Bring this unconditional acceptance into the world where there are those who are literally dying from lack of love. Go in peace. Amen. So grateful for that, let me tell you. So grateful. Oh, God.